Okay. So, could one of you please pray? Then we can get straight into God's word. Prince, would you be able to lead us in prayer?
Yes, sure, ma'am.
Yeah, sure. Go ahead.
Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I give glory to you in this time, Lord, in this morning, Lord. You've given us one more month in our life, Lord. Thank you for that. Lord, we pray as we're going to learn your word now. Help us to understand. Holy Spirit, help us according your will, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I pray that all the students are also Pastor Nancy. I pray your revelations in our life more and more before, Lord. Thank you. I pray. I submit all the student in your hand, all the time in your hand, Lord. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, in this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Prince. So in the last class, we saw how the Lord Jesus did one of the most powerful miracles, which was the resurrection of Lazarus. And once this was done, we expect that people will start trusting in him and believing in him. But we saw that the Pharisees and the Jews, you know, they were even more infuriated because they felt that people will now give their attention to Jesus. So that's what we were looking at. So they were plotting to kill Jesus. They were also upset about Lazarus. So they also had a plot to kill Lazarus. And this is what was going on. And at that time, we also saw how, the triumphal entry. We saw the Lord Jesus enter on a donkey. Okay, and he was greeted by the people with a palm branch, and this was in fulfillment of prophecy. So all this was taking place, and this was very close to Passover, very close to Passover. And we know that the Lord Jesus was crucified. Again, some say that it was on the day of Passover, some say that maybe it was the previous day, but around Passover is when the crucifixion of Jesus actually took place. So in what Jesus is actually doing now is he's preparing the hearts of his disciples, because the timing of his departure is very close. So a lot of what we are going to look at now is just in preparation to that. He's telling them again and again that I'm not going to be around, and I'm finally going to be completing what the Lord, what God has called me to do. So he is speaking, he has always spoken about his death, but now he's speaking more plainly, he's speaking repeatedly, so that his disciples are, well prepared for what is to come. So that is what is unfolding right now. And we also saw how when Mary, okay, she anoints Jesus, that is in a sense a preparation for his burial. Okay, and God is like, the events are unfolding in such a way that the work for which Jesus was born is finally going to take place. So I think we were somewhere at around verse, we did a couple of verses, but I will still back up at verse 20. Okay, I know we've touched a few verses ahead, but let's maybe look at some of these key verses, because it has a lot of meaning in it. So verse 20, there are some Greeks, who come and they want to hear Jesus, they want to talk to him. And Jesus, when they come, maybe these are just people who are seekers and they want to understand whether Jesus is the Messiah. So there are people who are coming seeking in a positive way. There are people who are coming in who are questioning him. despite all the I am claims. You know, so far we've seen the claims of Jesus, where he's very clearly spoken of him being the Messiah and the and also deity, but people were not willing to accept it. So you had people who came in to question that, and you know, repeatedly ask him, okay, tell us, who are you, who are you, because they were being, they felt threatened by the person and the works of Jesus. Now, when these Greeks come and ask to meet him, you know, he makes a statement, which is a very, you know, it's a very deep statement. In verse 24, he says, most assuredly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it produces much grain. He who loves his life will lose it, and he who hates his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. If anyone serves me, let him follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also. If anyone serves me, him my Father will honor. So I, in a very quick way, I had told in the last class that Jesus is talking about his own death, and he says when a wheat of grain falls to the ground and dies, so we know that whenever we plant seed in the ground, okay, we could think that the seed, when it is buried in the ground, it actually dies, because it is hidden away from us, okay, and it is hidden away from the light and the environment in which we live in. But you know, the going into the ground of the seed actually means that it is, it has a new beginning, that life is going to enter in such a way that this seed will now germinate into a plant, and then, you know, whatever that seed contains, the character of the seed is going to emerge so beautifully. And if that seed is meant to be a fruit-bearing tree, then, you know, it's amazing to see how out of that one seed, you see an amazing, you know, a marvelous, great, grand tree sort of coming up and yielding fruit to nurture and bless others. So, you know, in this, just having this picture in mind, what Jesus is saying is for the world and for Satan. Okay, Satan obviously is very happy with the idea that the Son of God is going to be betrayed, beaten, and killed. But you know, Jesus knows the depth of what God is trying to do through his mighty work. So Jesus is trying to explain to his disciples, I don't know how far they understood, but he's trying to tell them that the end in this case is actually the beginning. Okay, the death in this case is actually the resurrection. In the hopelessness of the situation that Jesus is going to die, there is actually hope. So, you know, he's saying that when the wheat falls into the ground and dies, so that is like the end. It remains alone, but if it dies, it produces much grain. So he's talking about the blessing that the cross is going to become to the world. And he was trying to reveal, I mean, there is revelation in this, but the disciples, you know, they were, maybe they were just getting bits and pieces of what he's trying to say here and there. You know, this temple, in 3 days, I will raise it up. If it is destroyed in 3 days, I will raise it up. So they're just getting bits and pieces of the understanding. And it could be possible that when the disciples thought that they are following the Messiah, like the others around, they must have also had this hope in their hearts that this man will overthrow the government and he will become one of those national leaders. You know, when Jesus came on the donkey and people waved the palm, you know, palm leaves, and they greeted Jesus, maybe even those who did that had an idea that this man, you know, he's done all the miracles and he speaks with authority, he knows scriptures, maybe he'll make for a better leader, maybe he'll make for a better national leader in comparison to the government officials whom we already have. So the disciples as well could have thought that Jesus is going to establish the government and, you know, we are going to become great in that government. He will give all of us a position. But you see, time and again, time and again. Jesus is repeatedly telling them that I'm going away. Okay, it's not how you thought. This government is not the way you have planned in your heart, but I'm going away. And he is repeating that. And he's also trying to help them understand that in his going away, in his death, there lies a blessing which is going to bring about redemption of, you know, all many people. So it's actually going to be a fruitful thing for him to die. And he's talking here, he's adding to it, and he's saying, he who loves his life will lose it. Okay, in the same vein, he's saying that, see, and whatever Jesus is saying, right, it is applicable to him, that he is going to let go of his life, and that will become a blessing for the people. That will be an act of obedience to the Father. But you see, as disciples, even for us, following the example of Jesus, okay, is something that will impact us in the same way. So if Jesus was ready to die, okay, and if Jesus was ready to lose his life, he's talking about losing his life, okay, and he's also talking about hating one's own life. So what does it mean? See, it's very simple. For us as believers, we don't have to die on the cross the way Jesus died. Because one perfect sacrifice was needed, and Jesus became that perfect sacrifice. However, for us, dying looks a little different. And that dying is us denying ourselves. Okay? So again, in verse 26, he says, if anyone serves me, let him follow me. So anybody who is a disciple of Christ, we may not, we definitely need not die on the cross like Jesus. Now, it may be possible that some of the disciples become martyrs. Martyrs are people who die for the sake of the gospel. So some may become martyrs. So literally, in that sense, they may die. But the dying, which is going to be applicable to every disciple, whether they die physically for the gospel as a martyr or not, is dying to self, denying self, following God, you know, walking in obedience. This is what Jesus is talking about. And in one sense, you know, death brings life. This kind of death is going to bring life. Okay? When we try to discipline ourselves for the sake of the gospel, it is very painful. It can be very painful for the flesh, because we want to do things the way we like. But we are learning here that we must walk in the example of Christ. And his example was to die to self. A wheat of grain falls to the ground, it is going to produce much fruit. So in that way, now, when we die to our own desires, when we die to what we think, you know, our life should be about, God can do so much from our lives, through our lives. So, you know, that is something that we understand by what the Lord Jesus did. And of course, you know, we saw how again he was telling them that I'm going away. So very strong and projecting this image to his disciples that I'm okay, I can face this. But you know, Jesus was real. We know that he was fully man and he was fully God. So he felt all the emotions that a human being would feel. So, you know, he did become vulnerable to his disciples. And he said, my soul is troubled. And what shall I say? You know, Father, save me from this hour. So Jesus was very honest with the people that he loved, the people that he worked with. And, you know, he was honest with God as well. He was not trying to make things look something different from what it actually was. So, you know, it's a big lesson for us about the way we relate to God. He was not engaging in, you know, sometimes prayer becomes a grumbling, arguing, complaining ministry. people take their problems to God and they are, you know, like bombarding God. Why God? Why? How? This and that. But, you know, that's not the manner in which he brought out his pain. It was a very honorable and a very reverent way where he says, God, honestly, like, my soul is troubled. You know, what shall I say? You know, Father, save me from this hour. Honestly, I want to escape because I know what I'm going to go through. The incidents that line up before him being actually crucified on the cross and the painful death on the cross. But still, you know, he gives in and he says, Father, glorify your name. Okay, so it shows us how to relate with God, even at times when we don't want to walk in the way which God wants us to take. Okay, but in an honorable way, Jesus is presenting his request before the Lord. And, you know, God affirms it. He confirms it and he says, yeah, I will glorify it. I have glorified it and will again glorify it. So, you know, in this manner, he is revealing. And again, we saw that one more passage where he says he's going away. He says, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. So again, there is a clue for the disciples. I'm going away. I'm not going to be with you physically. And of course, over here in this passage, we see he said that the ruler of this world will be cast out. So you see, he is introducing his death, which is coming up. But each time, you also notice that he is giving them the spiritual perspective of it. In the natural perspective, the grain falls to the ground and dies. So it's a very sad thing. But the spiritual perspective is, it is going to bear much fruit. Here again, he says that when I'm lifted up, what is lifted up? The elevation is a physical elevation because he will be on a cross. So he will be lifted up from the ground. But it's also a spiritual elevation where, you know, he will, through the cross, he would have done something for the glory of God's name that will redeem mankind. So that's another spiritual form of lifting up. And you see, he's proclaiming the victory of the cross here. And he's saying the ruler of this world will be cast out. So when we look at things only in the natural, seems hopeless. It seems like that is the end. Sometimes we wonder, God, how can a cross, you know, Paul writes in the book of Corinthians, he says, the cross is the wisdom of God. It is the power of God. Those who are of the world, right? For them, it is foolishness. If we only look at the natural about the cross, it seems like foolishness. Okay, I will be lifted up, grain falls to the ground. We feel sad. Oh God, we thought you're going to establish a government here, but you're going away and you're going to die in such a, you know, such a helpless way. What kind of a leader can this be? It's a natural way of thinking. Okay. So when we think about what God is doing in the natural, we use a natural mind, we know, right? Natural mind, spiritual mind, carnal mind. We don't grasp what God is up to. But when we look at it with a spiritual mind, then we understand, oh, okay, the grain falls to the ground, but it will produce much fruit. When I'm lifted up, I will draw all men unto myself, right? Or draw all men unto me. The ruler of this world will be cast out. So there are spiritual, there are spiritual results that are going to come from the natural that God, that Jesus is going to do. So for a spiritual person who understands these things, you know, it brings rejoicing that, wow, God has thought like this to bring victory for the people, to bring freedom for the people. And that is why Jesus has to go through this really painful death. Yeah. So Jesus is going on sharing and informing his disciples. People obviously, they didn't understand what he's saying because they were listening from natural mind. So they're asking him questions like, the Son of Man must be lifted up. Who is the Son of Man? You know, they're not able to understand. Then Jesus makes it a little more clearer, and he says, a little while longer, the light is with you. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. He who walks in darkness does not know where he's going. So remember, he introduced himself as the light of the world. So he was telling them that his earthly ministry was coming to an end. You know, it's beautiful how Jesus had such a sense of time. Earlier, do you recall? There were times when he said, my hour has not yet come. Now, what is he saying? A little while longer, the light is with you. So, he's so walking so intimately with the Father that even the journey of his own life, like which season of life this is, he had clarity. He knew earlier that nothing is going to happen to him because his time had not come. Now he's saying, a little while. And remember when we started this passage, I told us that you're roughly 1 week away, you know, 1 week from the Passover. So he knows about a week's time, everything that I have been living for, it is going to take place. And he is trying to clarify to the disciples and say, you know, this light, walk in the light as long as there is light. Okay, and obviously, you know, as we read this passage, we can interpret it more based on scripture, of course, because he says things like you may become the sons of light. So he was encouraging the disciples also and saying that, you know, if you understand me and you walk in my ways, you know, you will be like me. And that's what happened to the disciples later on, you know, when they gave witness to the resurrection power of Christ. So he's preparing their hearts. He's preparing their minds. He's preparing them for the future, you know, that they are going to walk into very soon. Yeah. You know, there were others who did not believe him, okay, despite his words and his signs. And of course, Jesus quoted from Isaiah and he kind of showed how, you know, scriptures already say that some people, their hearts will be hardened, their eyes will be blinded. So even though they are able to see, they are not able to understand what God is doing. And in the light of all this, you know, he encourages the disciples and he says, you know, that you go ahead and believe. Okay, the world will not believe, the people around will not believe, but, you know, I want you to believe. And he who believes in me, you know, you will also believe in him who sent me. So once again, you know, the concluding passage here in John chapter 12, that talks about the relationship that the Son has with the Father. Okay, so that relationship also comes in. So basically, you know, he's talking as if he's doing a work, but that is not just his work. He has been delegated. Delegation means somebody has sent you to do the work. Somebody has authorized you. So he's speaking about his relationship, his connectedness, but at the same time, his submission to the Father. Okay, so here you see, you know, he says, he who sees me sees him who sent me. So Jesus had come authorized by the Father, and his life, even earlier, we saw how he said, you know, I do only what I see the Father do. So he was talking about, you know, how he was walking so obediently. And he concludes this passage by making it clear. He says, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. Earlier, he said he does what he sees the Father do. Now he's saying, I speak, you know, as I hear the Father, whatever he tells me, I speak that. So this again shows us that Jesus was in incredible submission, or in other words, obedience to the Father. You know, just think about it. Jesus walked in great authority. We talk about that. But that authority can flow only out of submission. because he is so well submitted to the Father, he is able to walk in that authority. You see this, he says, for I, verse 49, for I have not spoken on my own authority, but the Father who sent me gave me a command, what I should say and what I should speak. So, he's making it clear that he's functioning out of the authority which he has received from the Father. And his statements here reveal that he's submitted to that authority. And therefore, in and through his life, we see great authority. Whenever he taught, you know, people looked at him and said, wow, you know, who is this man? How come he's talking with so much of authority, confidence? When he did the miracles, he said, Lazarus, come forth. The dead man came back to life. So there was power, there was authority in his words. There was authority displayed in the works that Jesus did. Where did that authority come from? His submission to the Father. So, you know, this applies to us. As long as we are sure that we are walking in submission to God, we are walking in obedience to God, you know, that is a place of great confidence. Whatever we are doing, whether in life, whether in personal life, whether in our ministry, we will move with confidence. We will move with greater authority. Okay, so we must remember that. So our submission to God is proportional to the authority that we walk in. So the more we are submitted to God, the greater the authority in which we can work or do ministry or, you know, live our everyday lives. But the lesser our authority, the lesser our submission, the lesser our authority. So Jesus was very well submitted to the Father, you know, great submission, 100% submission. So in the work which he did, he's able to be confident. Yeah, I'm doing only what the Father asked me to do. So I have nothing to be afraid of. Okay, so that's a big lesson for us today. Many of us, we are ministers of God, right? We will go, we will preach and teach and do many things in the name of God. But are we doing it out of God's direction? Yes, God told me to do this, so I'm doing it. Then you see great confidence, you see great authority flowing out of it. But let's take, for example, God tells us, like Jonah, you know, you go to Nineveh. But if I'm going to Tarshish, somewhere in my heart, I'm not submitted to God. God told me to go to Nineveh, but I'm going to Tarshish. So in that case, what happens? I'm not submitted. So I'm not able to flow with that authority and be confident that, hey, I'm doing this. I'm going to see God's blessing in my ministry. I won't have that confidence, right? So I'm telling you in a very simple way, but the essence is that when we are submitted to God, we can have great authority. But when we are not submitted to God, we will lack that authority. And you see the life of Jesus, very well submitted to the Father. No wonder, you know, he could be confident. He could go against the devil. He could cast out demons. You know, he could command, dead man came back to life. So submission in daily life is very, very important. Okay. So, okay, come, let's move on. Actually, we could go verse by verse, word by word, which is what I was trying to do earlier. But I think it's, you know, dragging a little bit. So, yeah, my apologies for that. I will try to just hit some key points so that, you know, you can get more out of it. Okay, let's continue. So I told us that these things, whatever is taking place now, this is in preparation to the death of Jesus. So he has spoken to the disciples, he's making it plain. And now, you know, he comes to, like before, the Passover, when Jesus was sure that, you know, he is going to be taken away, I'll read this verse because it gives a lot of meaning. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father. So we know timing is up, time is up. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. Okay, so now we will read about his relationship. Now we spoke about his submission to the Father. Okay, that's quite clear. Now we will talk about his relationship to the disciples. Now, how is he relating? John is writing here, having loved his own who were in the world. So he's making it clear that this is about his followers. This is about the people who came to learn from his life, or in other words, his disciples. What was the bond? You know, in a relationship, there's always something that is bonding, right? If it is a workplace, we honor our you know, boss or our leader. We have the same goal to achieve something for the organization. So that is the bond. That is the primary bond over there. But when you look at a family relationship or a marriage relationship, you know, there is love, which is bonding. We will talk about, of course, you know, there's respect and all other things, but the underlying thing we would say, hey, this is love. Because of love, you know, the parents are with the children. In the same way, what is the bond that Jesus had with the disciples? Was it, all of you, you know, I'll tell you what to do, you do it. It's like task, only task oriented, mission oriented, go and save the world, make disciples. You know, all those things are there, but the core bond of the relationship that Jesus had with his disciples is having loved his own. You see how Jesus is looking at the disciples. He's not looking at them as servants. He's not looking at them as, you know, some hired help, slaves. Okay, I'm delegating responsibility. That's all. No. Having loved. So there is a bond of love which Jesus has with the disciples. And we are told that he looked at them as his own. You know, we don't think like that about disciples. But that is the perspective which Jesus had for his disciples. He says, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them. How did Jesus love these disciples? It says, to the end. You know, and some people, they interpret this as till the time that he died, he had love for them in his heart. But there are others who interpret this and say that, you know, the love of God is eternal. So it is beyond his earthly life. Jesus loved them with that eternal love. So for us today, we are Jesus' disciples. What is the bond which he has with us? We can understand from here, you know, having loved his own, he looks at us the same way. You know, there is a bond of love. He looks at us as his own, not as, you know, some people whom he wants to get some work done by. So earlier, his relationship with the Father, you know, complete submission, we understood. His relationship with the disciples, love. Okay, seeing them as his own. Now, what is going on, you know, at this time? So preparing, in preparation to the Passover, they would have this very special meal, the Passover meal. Okay, John is kind of describing that Passover meal, he's talking about the events that took place around that meal. We know that people would have a meal with those who are close to them, okay, or those they want to build a relationship with in the Jewish culture. So Jesus was with his loved ones. He was with those that related closely with him, which are his disciples. So when the supper was ended, you know, John says it was ended, but you know, others, when you read their accounts, it seems like it was still ongoing. But anyway, when the supper was ended, the devil having already put into the heart of Judas Iscariot to betray him. Okay, so at this supper, you know, something strange took place. It seems like one of the disciples was already, you know, kind of away from God. You know, isn't it funny how Judas was there physically, but His heart was far away from God. And, you know, it is likely that his heart was far away from God for a while. Remember in the earlier passage when Mary poured that expensive oil on the feet of Jesus? He said, hey, this could have been given to the poor for 300 denarii. So Judas is thinking very differently. He's thinking in a very worldly way. Okay, and of course, Jesus knew it's, you know, the motivation with which Judas said. What he said was correct. Yeah, it could have been given to the poor. But Jesus understood the motivation. This man is after that money. He could have sold it and he could have, he probably has been doing this with the treasury. He was in charge of the treasury. So he's probably been doing it. So when we read here that the devil, having put it into the heart of Judas, it may not be the first time the devil is putting a thought in his heart. Okay. So Judas may have been opening up his heart again and again to the devil. You know, the devil, what does he put in our hearts? He will put envy, bitterness, anger against people. So many things. He'll put it in our hearts. But it's up to us. That is why we say we must renew our minds. That is why we say that, you know, we must keep out the devil, like give no room to the devil. So if Judas had cast out these evil thoughts, bringing every thought captive, I don't think on the day of the Last Supper, Judas, devil would have had this opportunity to put another thought into his heart. But seems like he was opening his heart again and again and again and again to the devil. So finally, you know, the evil one put the thought of betraying Jesus in his heart. Now, Jesus, okay, all this is going on. We'll see again, you know, how he interacts with Judas. But at this point, you know, what Jesus does is, he knew that everything belonged to him and that he had come from God, that he is going back to God. So he fully understands his authority. He fully understands his position. After knowing all this, you know, we are told that he got up, he laid aside his garments, he took a towel and he girded himself. So he just made himself, you know, that putting on a towel is a humble way of, you know, dressing yourself, or rather humbling yourself. So he humbled himself and he also poured water into a basin and he started to wash the feet of his disciples and wipe it with a towel. Okay, which towel? The towel that he had put on himself. So, you know, so much is going on. Jesus is going to go to the cross soon, and Satan has already spoken into the heart of Judas to get things moving for the arrest of Jesus. And in the midst of all this, calmly, you know, Jesus is doing something, and he's doing something special. This is to reveal, you know, how he loved his disciples and how he came to serve. Okay, the Son of Man, you know, he has come to serve. He has come to serve the people whom he created. Okay, and that is something amazing. And how does he choose to wash their feet? You know, Jesus, because he is the very Son of God, and by now, the people around, his own disciples, they look up to him. He could have told them, why don't you prepare a basin of water with some, you know, warm water or something, and yeah, bring me a towel. I want to wash the feet of the disciples. So he, washing the feet in those days was considered a very, you know, like a very low job. So one of the lowest disciples, they would do this thing of washing the visitors' feet and wiping it with a towel. So Jesus, even though he wanted to show his humility, he could have asked the disciples to prepare everything for him. He could have quickly gone, wiped and come back. But no, he humbled himself. He brought the water. He washed their feet. And you can imagine, you know, these are people who are mainly walking all over the place. Their feet must have been really, really dirty. Okay. And then we wonder, Jesus, why are you doing this? Why are you doing this? You know, obviously the disciples, you know, they would have seen that humility which the Lord Jesus is displaying. So Jesus is showing them by example that I am here to serve you. You know, if the Son of God is here to serve the people whom he led, you know, think about us, our lives. There are many people we influence, you know, maybe in our families, the younger kids, they listen to us. In our workplace, people listen to us. As leaders in the church, people listen to us. But here is a picture of servant leadership where we must love the people whom God has called us to serve and lead them with a heart of humility. You know, earlier in that passage of Jesus going on the donkey, you know, people shouted out, right, King of Israel, King of Israel. Can you imagine the King of Israel? He has become a servant and he is washing the feet of his disciples. You know, really shows that, you know, it doesn't affect Jesus's security in any way. That, hey, if I do this act of service to my disciples, will they think I'm very low? Will they stop respecting me? What if they don't listen to me? You know, there is no insecurity. He already knows who he is, where he came from, where he is going, that he's going to glorify the name of the Father, and a great sense of confidence, you know, in serving the disciples. And seems like he did it for all the disciples, but when he came to Peter, you know, Peter always had something to say. He had an opinion. So quickly, you know, Peter is saying, Lord, are you washing my feet? Meaning, please don't do this because you are great and you cannot touch my feet. You can't wash it. And Jesus says, what I am doing, you do not understand now, but you will know that, know after this. So Peter said to him, you shall never wash my feet. No, Peter is trying to be that one disciple who stands out. And he's trying to, you know, say that the other disciples, they were so foolish. No, they did not give honor to Jesus by letting him wash the feet. But I'm not going to do that. So you shall never wash my feet. And Jesus says, if I do not wash you, you have no part in me. At that point, you know, Peter got a revelation. So he says, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head. So, you know, it just shows us that God wants to cleanse us. So as a master, what did Jesus, he's humbling himself. Yes, that is one thing. The other thing is when he's washing the feet of the disciples, he's also cleaning them. And, you know, we have to let God clean us. And Peter understood that he was a sinful man and that he really needed, you know, God's word and, you know, God's presence and the working of God to clean him. So it is very important for us to let God clean us, you know, and be in that place of, again, submission to God and in a place of, you know, a state where our heart is humble. Every day, our heart should be in a place where we are ready to repent. If God shows us something within us that this is not right, we say, okay, God, wash me. Okay. And this is not just about washing. You see how Peter understood it. He said, not just my feet, Lord, but my hands and my head. So he understood that he needed cleansing much more than, you know, he realized. And just think about it. Jesus would have washed the feet of everyone, maybe even Judas. But it was not so much about washing outside, but we have to bring our hearts to God and say, God, wash my heart, wash my inner person, oh Lord. Okay. And Judas, he never let Jesus wash him inside. Maybe he let Jesus wash his feet, but that did not count. So the point that we take for ourselves as believers is we have to let God work in us in a deep way and let the Lord cleanse us inside out. Okay. And that is when we will be able to represent God really well. Now, when Peter says, Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head, Jesus says, now that Peter has understood that he needs God to work in him, now Jesus says, he who is bathed needs only to wash his feet, but is completely clean, and you are clean, but not all of you. For he knew who would betray him. Therefore, he said, you are not all clean. So now that Peter has come to a position where he has understood his need, you know, Jesus is saying that his word, right? Later on, we will see in John 17, 17, he says, my word is truth. And with the word of God, he cleanses us. So in that sense, Jesus has already cleansed them. They would have heard Jesus speak the word of life, the word of truth very often. So that has already done a work in them. But Jesus is now pointing out and he's saying, look, there is somebody among you who has never received this, or rather has not let this word work in them. And that person still remains unclean. So Jesus is washing the external, but he's making a reference to the internal. And he's saying, that if we don't let God's word work in us, you know, hearts will remain unclean. And Judas was that person who was not yet clean. Okay, so once Jesus has done this, he explains to them, he asks them, do you know what I have done to you? And then, you know, he tells them, that I being your Lord and teacher, that I have washed your feet, you also have to wash one another's feet. So this is to lead us to a life of, relating humbly with one another. Relating later on we see in the epistles, brotherly love. To be there for each other, be even humble. Scriptures tell us in Romans, Paul writes that don't think of yourself more highly than another person, right? So everyday life has to have that humble mindset, which is what the Lord Jesus displayed for us. So if he can be so humble, being our Lord and our teacher, we should also learn to be like him, okay? And then Jesus says in verse 16, most assuredly, I say to you, a servant is not greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than he who sent him. Okay? So we, therefore, we have to do what Jesus did because he is greater. And we have to follow his example of servant leadership. So whoever we are, whichever position God has given us, remember to serve people. Remember to be humble. Now, sometimes when Satan puts in our minds, why you want to be humble? No need. There's no need to be humble. You be like a lord over the people. That time we can remind ourselves, hey, wait a minute. In John 13, Jesus said, if I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. If Jesus has done it, I too must do it. Okay. All right. So it is 9:50. Let's take a break, class. We'll come back and we'll continue from here. Yeah. Thank you.